Okay, last question.
Yep.
So when you are not playing music, what are you doing?
I'm watching movies. I love the movies. In the not too distant future. Yeah, I'm a big fan of watching. Well, it's funny you mentioned Mystery Science Theater because that's one of my favorite all-time shows.
Yeah,
I love.
It's great.
I love that show. But yeah, I you know,
that's so cool on YouTube. They're yeah. all on YouTube now. On YouTube. So awesome. Yeah.
And there's like a 10,000. There's like a Mystery Science Theater app now that has all oh, really? The early stuff for free.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. But so yeah, I think my biggest pastime that I love to do is just chilling out and watching movies. It's
yeah.
like, you know, I've always been a big fan of music, movies and music.
So there's a great line by Lev Manovich that says that cinema essentially became a new branch of painting. Painting in time. Think about it. No other technology that preceded it for capturing the numinous, for clothing the numinous, unfolded in the dimension, the fourth dimension of time. So photography, we were able to take a picture of a moment. Ecstatic painting, again, creating a portrait, a snapshot of an ephemeral experience. Whereas cinema became this branch of painting that unfolds in time. And so consider that notion. All of a sudden, we had a technologically mediated dream space, a way to access, a portal to the numinous that unfolded in the fourth dimension. So cinema became a kind of waking dream where we could travel in space and time, where we could travel in mind. This became more than virtual reality. This became a real virtuality, the simulated catharsis, the symbolic allegorical hero's journey we got to take every time we watched a movie became real, right? Was literalized in our psyche. You know, we became literally soul surfers when we watch movies. And like the film Inception says, the director is able to architect what is essentially a dream space that the audience can then fill with their subconscious. You know, Linklater goes even farther. He says that that human beings knew how to watch movies because we've been doing it for hundreds of thousands of years already in the dream space. And so the reason that it was so natural, so intuitive, so innate for us to know exactly how to watch movies when these came online was because we've been doing it every night forever. So what we see with cinema is that technological advancements met consciousness in a new art form, giving us access to new numinous realms. And I love this notion because I love the transformative capacity of cinema as a maximum, ultimate expression of intersubjective explorations, transpersonal spaces, you know, the spaces of dream, the spaces of mind, liminal zones, you know, to push the limits of theatrical illusion to see what we can learn about ourselves.
Do you gravitate to anything or are you pretty open?
I'm open to anything. I love really shitty B movies. I like crime film. I love because I'm a graphic designer and a web developer and I work in Photoshop and all that stuff. I love like the effects driven stuff because
yeah.
it's amazing to me that you can the stuff you can do nowadays.
Yeah.
It's scary nowadays with deep fake stuff, but
right.
You know, I mean,
it's a different conversation.
Totally. But yeah, so I think I like it all.
Yeah, so you're probably like me. Like, it just kills me when, you know, just the internet trolls sometimes, you know, when that CGI sucks, you know, where I'm like, Jesus Christ, do you have any idea
what it takes?
Yeah, to do one simple little scene.
Yeah.
You wouldn't say that even if it did suck because you would feel bad
yeah.
because somebody's worked their ass off on
totally.
That thing, you know.
I had an independent film company with a buddy of mine for like we made independent films for like 3 or 4 years. And
that's awesome.
Yeah, and we had one film that went to like the Santa Fe Film Festival in New Mexico and got to present it there. And we were idiots. We didn't know what we were doing. We were just like, oh, let's make some movies. Let's do this. Yeah.
That's all right.
And when you see what kind of a thing, like we did a 3-minute short that we submitted to Project Greenlight. And mm-hmm. just to do that, the logistics of finding a place to film, and it had 3 locations, so we had to find 3 locations, and it was only a 3-minute film, and I was like, fuck man, this is hard.
Yes.
And I can't imagine what it takes to do a big production.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I worked with Matt at his place called Red Lux Productions, and
yeah,
we did like videos and music videos and stuff like that. And again, same thing, the logistics of filming a 3-minute video,
yeah,
is fucking amazing,
right?
Really hard.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. There's just so much that goes into it.
Yeah.
It's incredible. So, add on question to that: are there any movies or a movie that you can think of that really hit you from a sonic perspective, from the music?
The Crow.
Or, okay,
The Crow.
Yeah,
without a question. That fucking movie, to this day, is like my favorite film of all time.
Golgotha Tenement Blues, man. That song, you can. When I first heard that song, I thought I had fast forwarded like 10 years.
Yeah.
I was like, this sounds like something I've never heard before.
Yeah.
And amazing. That bass,
yeah.
Just the bass. I was like, how did they do that? It makes it sound so cool.
Yeah. Yeah. That absolutely, The Crow. I've watched it.
Big Empty. I mean, it's got so many good songs
on there.
Yeah.
And my sweet little daughter, when she was a little kid, it was like, welcome to the family. The first thing you're going to do is watch The Crow. And to this day, you know, she's 30 now. And to this day, she's like, I've got to watch The Crow. It's my favorite movie.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Which, speaking again of the 6 degrees inner circle.
There is no inner circle.
You know, John used to train with Brandon Lee.
Oh, wow.
Because John managed a gym out there
that's
for a
right.
while. And that's how he met Brandon through there. And he actually got to be pretty good friends with him. And, you know, train in martial arts with him. And,
went,
you know, he'd go have dinner with him and his wife, and he said he was just the coolest, you know, nicest dude that you can ever meet.
He seemed that for sure. And I was a huge Brandon Lee fan before The Crow, and I remember being so happy for the dude that he got that film, and I was so excited about it, and it was so fucking devastating that he was killed on set. And then, of course, the movie comes out. You know, his mother and sister, I think, made sure that to tell them, "Hey, you finished this film because it was his dream to do this."
Yeah,
out.
Right.
So, of course, they put the Crow out. You know, it came out. I think it was a year later because mm-hmm. they had to piece it together. You're right. They were close to being done, but there was a sub story they had to cut out.
Yeah, yeah.
They had to get a double.
I remember they
stuff.
Had to film. Yeah, that double some fight scenes and stuff. So luckily it was fight scenes, so you can kind of get around
that
it.
Whole scene in the Crow where you know the little girl goes up there and he walks in and there's rain coming down and he's putting the mat, you know, putting all the clothes on and all that stuff. That was filmed with a double.
Yeah.
Which I think was a guy from the John Wick. It was a stunt double.
Oh, really?
In John Wick.
Okay, cool.
But anyway, so
that's kind of fun.
Yeah, it's cool, right? But anyway, so when you go and see that movie after Brandon's been killed and it's so fresh, you know, the next year, and they talk about death and he talks about dying.
Oh, I know.
It's so like, fuck, it's just a weight over.
You mean when he talks about it outside of the film?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, not only outside of the film, but
inside of it. Actually,
when he talks about, you know, the whole movie is based on loved ones dying and coming back to put revenge on their death. And it's a weight on the whole film.
Yeah.
But the music for that film, that I think it's one of the best-selling rock soundtracks ever. I think it's sold 10 or 15 million copies. No surprise.
I would believe that.
And if you think about it, at the time when it came out, there were probably one or two musician bands on there that somebody actually heard of. You know, yeah. It was all picked out by the dude that what's his name? The guy that wrote The Crow, the original comic book.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
Okay.
I met him one time, and his name slips me. Sorry, dude.
Yeah, no. I did an episode with Drew. I haven't put it out yet, but I pulled in a clip from that guy.
Yeah.
So I know who you're talking about. I just can't think of his name either.
So, anyway, he was the one that picked all the music
for
the album.
Wow. I'm surprised they let him do that.
That was kind of in his rider, I think.
Okay.
Toby,
that's awesome. He was like, all right, look, we can make this movie, but I'm picking the movie music.
And Toby and I talk about this because he's a huge fan of The Crow. And funny story, the author, James O'Barr, is a huge fan of Marquis of Vaudeville. And before I was in the band, he'd come see the band play, talk about what a big fan he was. And Toby was a huge fan of James and The Crow. And so they had a lot of stories to share. And that was one of the things they talked about, was that James was the guy that picked the music for the soundtrack.
Yeah.
And it was such, you know, he got a bunch of naysayers and nobody's going to fucking care about who this is. And now it's one of the biggest selling soundtracks of all time. So
yeah, that's pretty cool for him. I'm sure I knew what I was talking about. Yeah. That's awesome, man. Yeah.